rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. Hope is stirring, hearts are yearning for you. We long for you. Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. Washed away. Hosanna. Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna, come and be way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Hear the sound of hearts returning to you. We turn to you. In your kingdom, broken lives are renewed. You make us new. Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. They're washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna, come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus.
You know, Father, as we gather here this evening, and certainly want to pray for our brothers and sisters that are homesick and are having to watch this by live stream, but Lord, as we gather here this evening, we set aside all of the distractions of the day and of tomorrow, and Lord, we just focus on you, Father. As we lift our hands in surrender and raise our voices in praise, as we open our hearts to the instruction of your word, Lord, we pray that you, by the power of your Holy Spirit, would just flood and fill this place. You know, Lord, we're going through a very difficult time. You know, as we're seeing prophecy fulfilled and as we're moving, Father, to that soon return of your Son, Jesus Christ, we need to be edified and instructed. We need to be lifted up and strengthened. And so, Lord, tonight as we wait on you, as we worship you, Father, fill our hearts, Father. Fill our hearts with your strength. Overshadow us with your presence. Fill us again, Lord, tonight with the power of your Spirit, we would pray. In the mighty name of Jesus. And all God's kids would say, amen. Hey, let's remain standing. Thank you.
One day when heaven was filled with his praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. The Word became flesh and the light shined among us, his glory revealed. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. One day they led him up Calvary's mountain, one day they nailed him to die on a tree. Suffering anguish, despised and rejected, bearing our sin, my Redeemer is he. The hand of healed nations stretched out on a tree and took the nails for me. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day, oh glorious day.
One day the grave could conceal him no longer. One day the stone rolled away from the door. Then he rose over death he had conquered. Now is ascended, my Lord, evermore.
Death cannot hold him, the grave cannot keep him from rising again. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day, oh glorious day.
Father, we stand in reverence of you, Lord, in honor of you. And Lord, we thank you for that day that you are going to come for us, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for the day that you redeemed us, that you bought us, Lord. Lord, help us come undivided in heart, undivided in mind, fully here, fully giving back to you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. You may be seated.
Jesus, Lord of heaven, I do not deserve grace that you have given and the promise of
your word. Lord, I stand in wonder of the sacrifice you made. Mercy beyond measure, my debt you freely paid. Your love is deeper than any ocean, higher than the heavens reaches, beyond the stars in the sky. Jesus, your love has no bounds. Your love has no bounds. Jesus, Lord of heaven, I do not deserve the grace you have given and the promise of your word. Lord, I stand in wonder of the sacrifice you made. Mercy beyond measure, my debt you freely paid. Oh Lord, your love is deeper than any ocean, higher than the heavens reaches, beyond the stars in the sky. Your love is deep, your love is wide, your love is great, your love is high, your love is calling out to me. Your love is all I ever need. Your love is deep, your love is wide, your love is great, your love is high, your love is calling out to me. Your love is all I ever need. Your love is deeper than any ocean, higher than the heavens reaches, beyond the stars in the sky. Jesus, you're no bounds. Your love has no bounds. Jesus, your love has no bounds. Your love has no bounds. And it's a deeper than any ocean, higher than the heavens reaches, beyond the stars in the sky. Your love is deeper than any ocean, higher than the heavens reaches, beyond the stars in the sky. Jesus, your love has no bounds. The greatest love that anyone could ever know, that overcame the cross and grave to find my soul. until I see you face to face. And grace amazes and takes me home. I trust in you. With all I am, I live to see your kingdom come. And in my heart, I pray you let your will be done. Until I see you face to face, and grace amazing takes me home, I trust in you. I will live to love you. I will live to bring you praise. I will live a child in awe of you. You are the voice that called the universe to be. You are the whisper in my heart that speaks to me. Until I see you face to face, and grace amazing takes me home, I trust in you. I will live to love you. I will live to bring you praise. I will live a child in awe of you. I will live to love you. I will live to bring you praise. I will live a child in of you. The greatest love that anyone could ever know, that overcame the cross and grave to find my soul. Until I see you face to face, and grace amazing takes me home, I trust in you. I trust in you. I trust in you. Jesus, be the center, be my source, be my light, Jesus. Jesus, be the center, be my hope, be my song, Jesus. Be the fire in my heart, be the wind in these cells, be the reason that I live, Jesus.
Jesus. Jesus, be my vision. Be my vision. Be my path. Be my guide, Jesus. Jesus, be my vision. Be my vision. Be my path. Be my guide, Jesus. Be the fire in my heart. Be the winds in these sails. Be the reason that I live, Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, be my passion. Be my passion. Be the love of my life. Be the love of my life, Jesus. Jesus, be my passion. Be the love of my life. Jesus, be my passion. Let's all stand. Be the love of my life, Jesus. Be the fire in my heart. Be the wind in these sails. Be the reason that I live, Jesus, Jesus. Be the fire in my heart. Be the wind in these sails. Be the reason that I live, Jesus, Jesus. Be the fire in my heart. Be the wind in these sails. Be the reason that I live, Jesus, Jesus. Be the love of my life, Jesus.
Yes. You know, with every head bowed and every eye closed tonight, just by a show of hands that the Lord can see tonight, if you have a need, just raise your hand. Let him see it. It's not that he doesn't already know it, but that's you acknowledging it to him that you have a need, whether it be physical, financial, emotional, spiritual, marital, family, relationships, whatever. You have a need. Just raise your hand tonight. And we pray, Father. Every hand that has been raised, whether it's in the building or watching by live stream, you'd meet that need. Lord, you told us, you gave us a special invitation that we can come into the very throne room to receive help and mercy in a time of need. And so we're coming tonight and we're just lifting these things to you. We certainly want to pray especially for Lisa, who the infection has come now after her cancer surgery. And Lord, we pray that you would just clear her body of any of that and all of it. And we pray for Susan, who's having some problems with her ear and this vertigo. Lord, we lift her before you. Pray for Ken Peltzer, Lord, who's got a chest cold, maybe pneumonia. Pray for John Kirksey, Lord, who was diagnosed with pneumonia. Pray for Ken, who's just coming off of pink eye. And just all of these other needs, Father, in our fellowship. The many that have been sick with the stomach flu and the head cold that's going around. We lift them before you as well. What a privilege and honor it is to come before the King of Kings and bring our needs. Leave them with you, knowing that you're going to take care of them. So we do so in the mighty name of Jesus, and all God's kids that say, amen. 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 We'll spend a few moments greeting one another before you find your place. All right, if you guys could settle into your spots. All right. Fellowship time is over. Okay, ladies. Ladies. It's always the ladies. Hey, this is a little loud for me tonight. Can we turn it down just a shade? Hey, listen, I got a couple of announcements, and each one of them are important. Look around. You'll see a lot of empty seats that people are normally here Wednesday night. Pray for them. Some of them are really struggling with pneumonia, chest colds, flu colds, and stuff like that, the stuff that's been kind of going around. That's good to see Ken here tonight. How's your eye? Did it offend you? Did you pluck it out? No? You're okay? Good. Hey, you got that one out. Hey, we can have fun going to heaven. Listen, I got a couple of announcements. Guys, if you're going, and there's 30 of us that are going up to the men's conference in Reno this Saturday. I just remind you, we're leaving the church at 7, so be here before 7. They have a continental breakfast up there, and lunch is up there provided as well for the $10. So then we'll hit Shields and Cabela's on the way back. Walk Through Jerusalem is coming real quick. So if you want to hand out cards, invite any of your family or friends, you need to do it right away. These cards are in the back for you to take. They're free. Just hand them out to your family, your friends, your neighbors, and invite them to walk through Jerusalem. Now, the week of that, there will be no Monday night or Wednesday night study, because Sunday the 20th, after Sunday, they start putting the chairs away and turning this into Jerusalem. So there won't be any Monday night or Wednesday night study the week of it, because the walk through Jerusalem is going to take up our Friday and our Saturday. We need people here Saturday after the last tour to tear all of it back down again. It takes a lot longer to set it up than it does to tear it down. Put it away and get ready for our Resurrection Sunday service. So make sure that you participate in that, because we'll need your help, especially to tear it back down and put it away. Okay? There was one other announcement, and I can't remember what it was. It's a terrible thing to get old. Well, hey, let's turn in our Bibles to the... Oh, there it is. See, it comes back to the book of Leviticus, chapter 25. We've come as far as verse 18, and that's where we're going to pick up tonight. When we're done with the book of Leviticus, we're going to get most of the way through chapter 26 tonight. We're going to finish chapter 25. Next week, we will be finishing the rest of chapter 26 and chapter 27. Yes, oh, I got it taken care of. And then after the Easter break, after we come back from Resurrection Sunday, the following Wednesday, we're going to start our series of topical messages. You'll look on the internet, there'll be a flyer of the different subjects. So you've got a little bit more time if you have a subject that you want us to address from the Scriptures to fill out one of those cards. You just take the prayer cards, fill out, put it on there, and put it in the box, and we'll list it. So far, we have subjects like prayer and fasting, spiritual warfare, marriage, the responsibility of the husband, the responsibility of the wife, parenting, what the responsibility of the parents are, giving, tithing, what does that look like? Just a whole series of messages. So if you have a subject that you want us to address in light of Scripture, make sure you fill out a card and put it in the back. Okay? Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word tonight and how we love to study it here at Calvary Chapel, Father. And you know, there's so much left as we're winding down now the book of Leviticus, as Moses is giving the final instructions to the Levitical priests as they're about to start their journey, Father, toward the promised land. And as they come into the land, this will be the centerpiece of their worship, this tabernacle and all of the instruments and all of the commandments, Lord. And so as we look at these things, Father, there's much that we can glean from that in the New Testament. So speak to our hearts tonight. There's a lot before us this evening. And Lord, help us to retain, give permanency to those things that we learned tonight. We ask in the mighty name of Jesus. And again, all God's kids would say, amen. I know we came as far as verse 21, but we're going to back up for a moment because there's some things that are very interesting to us that are applicable for us tonight. Now, thus far, what we have seen is that God has delivered the nation of Israel out of Egypt. He brought them to Mount Sinai, and there he descended upon that mountain in a very awesome way to declare who he was to them. He's had Moses come up. Moses has received instruction. The tabernacle now and all of the furnishings has been built. The commandments have been given. The priesthood has been ordained and consecrated. And now we're just getting some final instructions before that everything begins to take place, if you will. And I think that what is before us tonight is extremely interesting, especially when we get into chapter 26, because here he gives in chapter 26 kind of a covenant kind of a thing. If you will do this, then I will do that. If you don't do this, this is what I'm going to do. And that's kind of how God ties a knot in it before they begin, you know, again, this temple worship. So let's read verse 18. Wherefore ye shall do my statutes, those things that I've instructed Moses to instruct you, those things that I've instructed Moses to instruct Aaron and the Levites, those things that were from God to you, wherefore you shall do my statutes and keep my judgments and do them. And you shall dwell in the land in safety. Here's a promise. If you are obedient, and it doesn't mean if you're perfect. Because in the opening chapters of Leviticus, if you sinned, God made provision for your sin and for your trespass. There were offerings that you were to bring. There was a process that you were to go through and a procedure whereby that sin could be removed from you. And we read over and over, and your sins will be forgiven. It's not perfect. But he's saying, if you will keep my statutes and my judgments, Then you shall dwell in the land in safety. And the land shall yield her fruit. And the idea is that you're going to be blessed. And you shall eat and be filled. And you shall dwell in safety. And so God is now, as he's coming to the end of this thing, is giving some instructions. He's kind of putting his hand of blessing upon what he has said. If you will do this. And listen, there's always a blessing in obedience. To obey is better than sacrifice, to hearken more than the fat of rams. God wants obedience from us. And in those moments when we fail to be obedient, what he wants from us is to be obedient to repent, to confess, to acknowledge that, Lord, what we have done has been a sin against you, and we're sorry, and we're asking for your help not to continue to do those things, you see. And he says, wherefore, if you will do this, if you will keep my statutes and my judgments, then listen, you will dwell in the land safely, and the land will yield her fruit, and you shall eat, and the idea is to be full, and you will dwell in safety. Now watch this in verse 20. This is important. There's a real principle that he's going to lay out to us for us here. And if you shall say, what shall we eat in the seventh year? Behold, we shall not sow nor gather our increase. Now, wait a minute, Lord, you said you're going to bless us, but you've just instructed us on this Sabbath law, this years of Jubilee, that 6 years we can sow and reap. On the seventh year, we can't sow. The land has to remain fallow. It has to remain, you know, at rest. What are we going to eat the seventh year? Now, here's the principle that I want you to see. Whenever God asks of you to be obedient in a certain area, there's always a challenge to that. See, it takes faith. It takes faith. God says, I'm going to ask you to be obedient, and I'm going to ask you to be obedient about something that you may not quite logically figure out. That's why Proverbs 3, 5, and 6 says, trust the Lord with all of your heart. Lean not to your own understanding. But in all of your ways, acknowledge him, and he will what? Direct your path. Trust in the Lord with all of your heart. Whatever God has said, trust it. Because it is for your benefit. And lean not to your own understanding. I can't tell you how many Christians that I've counseled in the 30-some-odd years I've been a senior pastor, that when they come in my office, I tell them what God says about the certain situation that they're going through, and what they'll tell me is, that won't work. And then I say to them, well, is what you're doing right now working for you? How is that working for you? You see, your problem is you're not trusting the Lord. I've had people say to me, well, if I tithe 10% of my income like God says in the Word to do, then I won't make it to the end of the month. How do you know? Trust the Lord with all of your heart. Lean not to your own understanding. Whatever God says, just do it. Greatest advice ever given in the Bible was given by the mother of Jesus at the wedding of Canaan. You remember when they ran out of wine, they came to her and said, we're out of wine. And the idea was, because she was the hostess, what are you going to do? And she points to her son Jesus and said, whatever he tells you to do, do it. And that's the idea here. He's saying, listen, if you're obedient, if you keep my statutes and walk in my judgments and do them, you will dwell in safety. In fact, not only will you dwell in safety, the land will yield fruit to abundance. You'll be filled and you'll be safe. And then he says, as we've been reading through chapter 25, the land has to lie at rest the seventh year. 6 years you can harvest, the seventh year at rest. You can plant again the eighth, and you can reap. And the question is, well, what are we going to do? If we do what you said that we should do, how are we going to eat? How are we going to be taken care of? How are we going to take care of our families? And listen to what God says in verse 21. I will. And there's a series of I wills as we go through chapter 25 on into chapter 26. There's a number of them, and these are promises of God. Listen, I will command my blessing upon you in the sixth year, and it shall bring forth fruit for 3 years. This is how I'm going to do it. If you will be obedient, then I will command my blessing upon you. And that sixth year, it's going to produce enough food to take you through the seventh, eighth, on into the ninth. It'll produce enough food for the 3 years. If you are obedient, I will command my blessing upon you in the sixth year, and it shall bring forth for 3 years, and you shall sow the eighth year and eat of the old fruit until the ninth year, until the fruit comes in, you shall eat of the old store. And the land shall not be sold forever. So he's telling them, listen, I'm going to bless you. If you're just obedient, even if you don't understand, even if you can't get it all figured out, even if it's a little fearful, even if you have to step out in faith and just trust, if you are obedient and you do what I've commanded and my statutes and my judgments, then listen, I will bless you. I will bless you. And you will have an abundance. And then he's going to talk about the land, and we're going to finish out the instructions on Jubilee and property rights and real estate rights. And so he says this in verse 23, because they lived in an agrarian society and your livelihood was connected to your property. You know, it wasn't an industrial society where you went to work and you got a paycheck. You farmed to produce food. Now, a number of years ago, I was in Africa, and one of the young men that was there at our church plant came to me and he says, you know, I wished I could move to America. You guys are so blessed in America. You know, we see pictures of America, and man, what a wonderful place that must be. Now, I know something about the kingdom, the Tororan kingdom, and so I asked him, I said, you're a young man, right? And he said, correct. I said, when you turn 21, is it true that you're giving a certain amount of property? He goes, yes. And I said, on that property, you're able to take the clay and build the bricks and harvest the bamboo and make a house like everybody else lives in. Is that correct? Yes. And then you can plant on that property, and you have bananas, and you have cassava root, and you have all of these vegetables and stuff. And I said, is that correct? He said, yeah. I said, you're more wealthy than any person in America that I know of. You own your own property. You own your own house. You have a means by which you can support you and your family. Now, you have to work at it, but you can do that. I said, if I miss a house payment, if I miss several of them, they come and get my house and I'll be homeless. And if I don't go to work and make a paycheck, I don't eat. And the guy says, well, it looks like you've been making a paycheck. Yeah, well, it's true. But listen, they lived in an agrarian society and everything was associated to rain and to the land and to their property. Listen carefully what the Lord says here. This is very important. The land shall not be sold forever. When they came into the land, the 12 tribes divided up the property. The only one that didn't get a possession was the tribe of Levi, because God was their possession. So they got property, and that property belonged to the Lord, and it was a gift to the nation of Israel. And it was a gift that was never to leave them. Now, they could sell it temporarily, but it always had to come back on the year of Jubilee to them. Now, watch this. The land shall not be sold forever, for the land is mine. All of that property, the Lord said, is mine. For you are strangers and sojourners with me. I'm giving that to you as a gift, and you don't get to sell it. If your brother be waxen poor, if he makes some bad decisions, doesn't plant his crops at the right time, just whatever he does, and he messes up, and hath sold away some of his possession. In order to survive, he sold some of his property. And if any of his kin, now they can redeem it, shall come to redeem it, then it shall be redeemed, that which was his brother sold. Or if the man can redeem it, then he can redeem it if he's able to redeem it. Then let him count the years of the sale. So if you had a piece of property as you came into the land, say you were the tribe of Judah, and as the tribe of Judah came into the promised land, God said, this section of property over here belongs to the tribe of Judah. So all the tribe of Judah would go over to that section of land, however many acres it were, and they would say, every male, raise your hand, raise your hand. And then they divided up the land and said, this acreage over here belongs to you. It's God's gift to you. It's yours forever. If you sell it, on the year of Jubilee, the 49th year going into the 50th year, that will come back to you. It can never be sold forever. It's my gift. And I think it speaks of salvation. Because from the fruit of the land, they were blessed. And it can never be It can never be sold away. On the year of Jubilee, it will always come back to you. Now, if you sell it on the 40th year, maybe you get into some hard times and you need some money. You need money to buy seed. You need money to sow the rest of your property or whatever. You can sell part of your possession or all of your possession. Let's say you sold it on the 40th year, part of it, and on the 42nd year you had such a harvest that you could actually purchase it back. You can, and it's prorated. If you sold it on the first year, then it's prorated for the 49 years. If you sell it on the 40th year, it's prorated for the 9 years. So it's a prorating to buy it back is the idea here. But if you're not able, verse 28, but if you're not able to restore it to him, then that which is sold shall remain in the hand of him that bought it until the year of Jubilee. And in the year of Jubilee, it shall go out and it shall return unto his possession. So it would always come back. So that's the law of Jubilee. The land that was given to you by God, divided up by tribes and heads of each tribe, each male in the tribe, that property belonged to you forever. It was inheritance to your children and your children's children. If you sold it, you could redeem it, or one of your family members could redeem it. If it wasn't redeemed, then in the year of Jubilee, it still came back to you. It was your possession. Verse 29. Now he's going to talk about houses in the city. And in verse 31, he's going to talk about houses in the country. And then in verse 32, he's going to talk about the houses that belong to the Levites. When we get over into chapter 25, verse 35, he's going to talk about taking care of the poor as we work our way through, and then he'll finish out on the laws of Jubilee. So let's read. And if a man sell a dwelling in a walled city, the idea is maybe you're doing business in a city and you buy an apartment or you buy a house. Now, you can have a livelihood without that house. Or maybe you buy the house in the city so that when you go on vacation, you have a place to stay. It's not connected with your livelihood. It's something that you could live without. And so he says this, if a man sells a dwelling house in the walled city, then he may redeem it within one whole year of the sale. Within a full year, it may be redeemed. So if you get in a tight position and you say, well, I have to sell this piece of property that I have in the walled city. It's away from my possession here in the land that I have. Then you have 1 year to redeem it back. And if you cannot, read verse 30, and if you're not able to redeem it in the space of one full year, then the house that you have sold in the walled city shall be established forever to him that bought it, and through his generations it shall not return in the year of Jubilee. So you're just kind of laying out some laws of Jubilee. If you sell a piece of property that's not connected with your livelihood, if you bought a house in a walled city, those cities were not really given to any one person. They were just pieces of property where they planted their cities and the farms were around them. If you sold that, it doesn't come back to you. But verse 31 says, but the house of a village which have no walls around about it, them shall be counted as the fields of the country. They may be redeemed, and if not, they come back at the year of Jubilee. Because it's probably a house that you're living in while you're farming your property. And if you had to sell it, it is connected with the fields, it's connected with your property, it comes back on the year of Jubilee. You know what's interesting is we're kind of going through this, you say, well, how does that apply to me today? Do you understand that bankruptcy, the law of bankruptcy comes from this principle of Jubilee? Now, I've had Christians come to me and say, you know, I've gotten in a bad way. Man, I made some horrible financial mistakes, and I don't see any way out. I'm going to have to file bankruptcy. You see, the idea of Jubilee is that every person, listen carefully, in their lifetime should have the opportunity to start over at least once. And again, I think it speaks of salvation. We get an opportunity to become a new creature in Christ. And whatever God gives on the year of Jubilee, it always comes back. So the idea is there. Now, when we come to verse 32, it's the houses of the Levites. Now, you know when the Levites came into the land, as the land was being divided up, they had no possession. They weren't given any land. And the Lord said to them, I'll be your possession. So here's what it says. Notwithstanding the cities of the Levites and the houses of the cities of their possession may the Levites redeem at any time. If they were to sell their house, they can buy it back any time. And if a man purchase of a Levite, then the house which is sold and the city of his possession shall go out in the year of Jubilee for the house of the city of the Levites, and their possession is among the children of Israel. So if he sells his house on the year of Jubilee, it comes back to him. His livelihood is in the temple. That house is associated with his livelihood, and if he sells it, it should come back to him. And so God's just laying out these laws of property, of real estate, how you can sell it, how you redeem it, what it comes back. And I think all of those speak to us about our salvation and the possessions and gifts God's given us. Now when we come to verse 35, it says this. Well, let's read verse 34. But the field of the suburbs of their cities may not be sold, for it is a perpetual possession. Anything that was associated with your livelihood was redeemable. Anything that was associated with your possession given by God was redeemable. But if you had something like a house in a walled city and you sold it, you had just restrictions on how you were to redeem it. Now watch verse 35. God has great concern for the poor. Did you know that? And I want you to see that it wasn't the government's job to take care of the poor. Now, I know that no doubt our government's heart was in the right place when they started a welfare program many, many, many years ago. But it's been abused. Because, listen, God wants us looking to Him for our sustenance. Now, if you know anything about civilization, every civilization, get your pen and paper out, that have prospered, have been built upon, and I went over this with the men in our men's Bible study a few weeks ago, on four pillars. In fact, the United States is the only country in its inception was built upon the four pillars that will sustain a society, biblical pillars. Now, you probably heard a lot about our founding fathers being deists. That's not true. Revisionists are trying to rewrite history. They weren't deists. Many of those were pastors. They were godly men. They started every session before they drafted the Constitution and the Bill of Rights and the Declaration of Independence with 2 and 3 hours of prayer. Every session started with that. Then they would go through their business. They would end every evening their business by having somebody come, one of the guys that was there, preach the Word of God, and then they would close in prayer. So they gave careful prayer over all of the documents that were going to control and govern this nation. In fact, George Washington made the statement that a nation cannot be rightly governed without the Word of God. It flows every precept and every statute. If we're going to be a blessed nation, that's why prayer was given to this. And they founded our nation on four pillars. By the way, every one of those pillars have been removed. That's why we're not dwelling safely and we're not being blessed anymore. I don't want to get into a political thing, but it is a spiritual principle. What are the four pillars? Number one, God is the creator of all things, heaven and earth. What do they teach in school today? Evolution. And now because evolution has been proved to be a false science, because now we've studied the genome and we know that, as the Bible said, each after their own kind, that dogs can't become horses and monkeys don't become men. Now some men can become monkeys, but it's never the other way around. So now it's panspermia. You'll see a lot of hubbub today of trying to find some kind of bacteria on some kind of rock floating, because they believe that life came here from outer space. Because they can't acknowledge that God, the Eternal One, the Lord of Glory, spoke everything into existence. God is creator. The second pillar is that God is the sustainer. And we replace God as a sustainer with our government. You look to the government. Bernie Sanders is doing a wonderful job, because socialism is against the Word of God. I love one of the signs I saw the other day. And I'm, listen, don't get in a huff if you're a Democrat and you think I'm bashing. I'm not, but I saw a sign the other day. It was a Bernie Sanders sign, and it says, "Socialism, you make it, we take it." I actually saw the sign. You make it, that's socialism. It doesn't work. Then who's responsible for the poor? Who's responsible? God will use you and me to take care of our neighbor. Who's responsible for the widows in this church? This church is. We are. as the community of believers. We're going to see that when we get that. The third pillar is that the Word of God is the standard for morality. God is creator, God is sustainer, God alone, and His Word is the standard of morality. And then lastly, that man is fallen, and he is in need of a Savior. This country was founded on those four pillars. And God is no longer the creator in this country. He's not being taught and held as that because we've gone to science, evolution, or panspermia. God is sustainer. Now we're looking to the government to take care of us. We want free everything. In fact, if everything was free, my question is, who works to support that? There's a tip-over point coming in our economy where the people that are working can't support the people that aren't working, and it just isn't going to work. But God is sustainer. The Word of God, we're seeing the Ten Commandments taking out of courthouses, and we're not following the Word of God. The Word of God is the standard for morality. As George Washington said, you cannot rightly govern a nation without it. And that we are fallen and in need of a Redeemer, which would remove humanism. Humanism teaches that man is the end of all things, and he can solve all of his problems. But the Bible teaches that you're fallen. And you need a Savior. Those are the four pillars. Now watch what we see when we come here. It says this, "And if thy brother be waxen poor and fallen into decay with thee," you see it, he's beside you. He's somebody that you know. He lives in your community. He lives in your sphere of influence, and you see it. It's like the Good Samaritan that's walking down the highway and he sees a guy that's fallen into rough times. He's been beat up and robbed. Whose responsibility is that man now? It's the Good Samaritan's, because he's there, he sees it. Well, he's not his brother. It doesn't matter. He is his, you know, that's what they asked Jesus. Well, who's my brother? Who's my neighbor? That man that has fallen into rough times that you see, that you know, is your neighbor. He is your brother. You are responsible to help him. That's the attitude. That's the idea. Watch this. "And if thy brother be waxen poor or fallen into decay with thee," you see it, "then thou shalt receive him, yea, though he be a stranger or a sojourner, that he may live with thee." You take him in. You nurse him back to life. You take care of him. That's the welfare program of the Bible. That is the responsibility of the one who sees it. It's not the government's responsibility. It wasn't the Levite's responsibility. Wasn't the priest's responsibility unless they saw a guy. But as you come in contact, as God directs your path, because the Bible says the steps of a righteous man are ordered to the Lord, and if that's true, if God brings you into contact with somebody that is in need, God has done that for you to help. Now watch this. So as you're helping, there's rules. Verse 36. "Take thou no usury from him," and the usury there, you can circle it right above it, interest. So you say, "Man, I see you falling into some hard times. You need some money. Hey, let me give you $100. And by the way, when you bring the $100 back, bring it back with 10 more for interest." You don't get to do that. And the idea is you don't take advantage of somebody that has fallen into hard times. You don't take advantage of their situation. You're not allowed to prosper from somebody else's pain. Is the idea. You know, when this whole housing thing, the bubble popped in 2008, I saw a lot of real estate agents running around trying to take advantage of these people that bought houses high and they were crippled and the whole real estate market. And I had a real estate agent come to me and said, "You know, what I'm doing is right." I said, "What you're doing is not right. It's not right. It's not right." Now, you can help that person sell, you can advise that person, but you shouldn't be making profit. According to the scriptures, now that's my opinion, this is what the Bible says, profit off of somebody who's fallen into hard times. There's a lot of real estate agents, and we have a bunch of them in our church that help people through that time, that advise them, okay, here's a quick sell, here's how you can get out from under your debt, here's how, and they help them, but they didn't buy their houses and flip them later when the market got better and profit off of these poor people. That's the idea. You're never allowed to profit off of the misery of somebody else. This is what God is saying. "Take no usury of him or increase," don't be increased by his demise, But fear thy God, that thy brother may live with thee. Thou shalt not give him thy money with usury, nor lend him your food, victuals, in the old King James, for increase. Don't look to make a profit from it. I am the Lord your God, which brought you forth out of the land of Egypt to give you the land of Canaan, and I will be your God. The idea is, when you were in misery, I brought you out from bondage. When you were in hard times, I fed you and I watered you, I led you and I guided you, and I'm going to give you a land. In fact, the indication was when you went into the land, you're going to live in houses you didn't build. You're going to drink from wells you didn't dig. You're going to eat from vineyards and from orchards you didn't plant. I'm going to give that to you. And as I have blessed you, you need to have the same heart of grace to bless others. If you find somebody that's fallen into a situation that there's a need there, and you're able to meet that need, don't withhold. In the New Testament, it says, don't withhold good when it's in your hand to give it. And that's the idea. And if we were doing that, there would be no need for the government to take over and try to do all of that, right? Okay, watch this. Verse 39, and if thy brother that dwelleth by thee be waxen poor, and be sold unto thee. So you buy him. He comes to you, knocks on your door, and says, listen, I've sold all my property. I know that it'll come back in your jubilee for the inheritance, but I can't support my family. And it's one of your brothers. It's a Jewish man who comes with his family, knock on the door. There he is. He said, I want to sell me and my family into slavery. You could do that in that day. And I want to come and live on your property. I want you to take care of me, and I'll work. I'll work for you. Here's what he says about that. So if a guy falls into that place of destitution, where he literally has to come to your house and say, you know, I'm willing to sell me as your hired hand. I'm willing to sell my wife. She can cook and clean. I got three good strapping boys here that can cut wood, that can farm, that can, you know, here's the deal. We're willing to sell ourselves into slavery to you. Here are the restrictions. They could do that, but here are the restrictions. Thou shalt not compel him to serve as a bondservant. You may purchase him, but it's like hiring him as a hired hand, not as a slave. And there's indications how he's to be treated. But not as a bondservant, but as a hired servant, as a sojourner. He shall be with thee and shall serve thee unto the year of Jubilee, and then he's to be released. Then shall he depart from thee, both he and his children with him, and shall return unto his own family and unto his own possessions of his father. As it comes back to him, shall he return. For they are my servants, which I brought forth out of the land of Egypt. They shall not be sold as bondmen. No Jewish man or his family that belonged to the Lord. God said, I rescued them from Egypt. It's the whole idea of you and I being rescued. Egypt's a type of the world. Moses is a type of Christ. Pharaoh's a type of Satan. The deliverance of Israel was a type of salvation. Going through the Red Sea is a type of water baptism. The rock that fallen around is Christ watering us, the Word, the Holy Spirit. All of that is typology. And what God is saying, you belong to me. You can't be sold to somebody else. You're bought with a price. You're not your own. You belong to me. And God is saying, as an illustration here, if somebody falls into a bad way and has to come to you and say, I'm willing to sell myself. I'm a Jewish man. You're a Jewish man. I'm willing to sell myself to you as an indentured servant that I might take care of my family. You can bring him in, but he is to be like a hired servant, not as an indentured servant. He's to be treated differently. And then he says this in verse 43, thou shalt not rule over him with rigor. You don't treat him disrespectfully. But you shall fear the Lord your God, both thy bondsman and thy bondsmaid, which thou shalt have, shall be of the heathen that are round about you. Of them shall you buy bondsmen and bondmaid. If you find a Gentile, yes, you can buy him. And he can become your indentured servant. But not so with your brothers. If he's a Jewish guy, you can only say, okay, brother, I can't buy you. You're not going to be my slave. But come, live in my home. I will hire you to do work around my farm. And I will treat you like a hired servant. I will treat you with respect. And that's the idea. Verse 45. Moreover, the children of Israel moreover, the children of the stranger that do not sojourn among you, of them you shall buy, and of their family that are with you, which they begat in your land, and they shall be your possession. And you shall take them as an inheritance of the children after you, and an inheritance of the possessions. They shall be your bondmen forever. If you buy them, they can be your bondmen forever. But over your brother, the children of Israel, you shall not rule over them as one that has rigor, or make them your indentured bondservant. If he be a sojourner or a stranger, and he wax rich by thee, and thy brother that dwelleth by thee wax poor, and sell himself into the stranger or sojourner by thee, or into the stock of a stranger's family, after that he is sold, he may be redeemed again. One of his brethren may redeem him. So if you've got a Jewish guy and they fall into poverty and a Gentile buys him, the idea is the Jewish guy has to go and redeem him out of that. Something very special is being said here. Now watch verse 48. After that he is sold, he may be redeemed again. One of his brethren may redeem him, either his uncle or his uncle's son, or may redeem him. And so he goes to the rights of those being redeemed. And then you can read down through the year of Jubilee. It's kind of a repetitiveness, but we get to verse 55. Let's kind of skip there because I want to get to chapter 26. For unto me the children of Israel are servants. They belong to me. And they are my servants, whom I brought forth out of the land of Egypt. I am the Lord your God. So if a brother falls into poverty, it is your job to help him. He's never to be brought in as an indentured servant. He can be brought in as one that you are hiring. But you treat your brethren with respect. Amen? Okay, now as we move into chapter 26, this is the interesting part, and we've got about 20 minutes to do the first half of chapter 26 tonight. Go back now with me so that we finish the law of Jubilee and the law of real estate and the law of purchasing servants. But I want you to go back again to verse 18 of chapter 25. It's almost like Moses regresses for a moment. He makes a statement in verse 18, as we just read a few minutes ago, on down through verse 21. Then he regresses as he finishes up the laws that concern Jubilee, purchasing of real estate, buying of servants, welfare, taking care of the poor. But then in chapter 26, he comes back to this same idea. So let's read it, and then you'll see what I'm talking about. Verse 18 says, wherefore you shall do my statutes and keep my judgments and do them, and then you'll dwell in the land safely. And the land shall yield its fruit, and you shall eat and be filled, and you shall dwell in safety. That's if you're obedient. Now, if you have question about something I've asked you to do, just be obedient. It'll all work out. Then I will command my blessing upon you. That's what God is saying. So now let's come to chapter 26, verse 1. And God just begins to lay out instruction. Again, by way of reminder, Peter said in the New Testament, we don't so much need to be taught as reminded of the things that we already know. Now, there's been a long period of time since they've come to Mount Sinai. Moses has gone up, he's brought down the law, he's gone up, he's got the instructions, they spent all the time building the tabernacle, all of the instruments of worship, all of the clothes for the priests, all of the instruction to the priests, everything has been set in order. And it's taken a number of months to do this. So as they're about to institute this religious system, again in chapter 26, as we're closing out the book of Leviticus, the instructions to Leviticus priesthood, God reminds them again of these things. Now watch. You shall make you no idols nor graven images, neither rear up any standing image, neither shall you set up any image of stone in your land to bow down to it, for I am the Lord your God. You shall have no other gods before me. Nothing is to be more important, listen to me tonight, nothing is to be more important to you, not your house, not your car, not your 401k, nothing is to be more important to you than me. You are to love, the Shema says, the Lord your God with all of your heart, soul, mind, and strength. I am, God is saying, to be your master passion. Now, if you do that, all of these other things, seek ye first the kingdom, all of these other things will be added unto you. Listen, God is saying, if you're obedient to the things I'm telling you, you're never going to have to worry about where you live or what you eat or what you wear. I will take care of you. I will command my blessing upon you. If, and it's conditional, if. And so he says here, you shall make none of these images before me, for I'm the Lord your God. You shall keep my Sabbaths and reverence my sanctuary. I am the Lord. If, now watch this, it's conditional. Because blessing and cursing, the blessing of the Lord or the punishment of the Lord, all relies upon what you do. You have a choice in it. It is conditional. And here's what God says. If you walk, and the idea for walk, there, circle it, means that's your manner of living. That's how you live. It's not, some, you know, this life of Christ that we live in the New Testament, or as they lived before the great God of heaven in the Old Testament, the Father, listen, it was conditional on your behavior. He says this, if you walk, and we see this word used a lot in the Greek in the New Testament, your manner of living, if you walk in my statutes, get this, and keep my commandments to do them. You see, the blessing is an obedience. If, here's the condition, you walk in my statutes and you keep my commandments to do them, then I will give to you rain in due season, and the land shall yield her increase, and the trees of the field shall bear their fruit. And your threshing shall reach unto the vintage, and the vintage is the harvest. So what you harvest this year will continue to be a blessing to you and feed you till the next harvest. You'll never be without. And the vintage shall reach unto the sowing time, and you shall eat your bread to the full, and you shall dwell in your land safely. God is saying to us in the New Testament, same principle, if you are obedient. By obedience, you put yourself in a position that God can bless you. Now, in the New Testament, if you are saved, and how many are saved? You've accepted Christ as your Savior. That is a gift from God. And it will never be taken from you. He who began that work in you will finish it. That is, and we're going to be talking about justification on Wednesday nights and sanctification. One of the questions was asked is, what's the difference between justification and sanctification? And we'll bring out that doctrinal premise when we get there on Wednesday nights. But let me say this. If you're saved, that's one thing. But God's ability to bless you as a believer is dependent upon your obedience. Because either you go to the woodshed for being disobedient, or listen, you get his hand of blessing on you for being obedient. Doesn't mean you lose your salvation, but really how you live before the Lord, how you walk in his presence, really does determine your blessing. Now watch this principle. Doesn't determine you losing or you know, your salvation, but it does determine whether God can bless you. And he's saying, if you will keep my commandments, walk in my ways, keep my statutes, then listen, you will be blessed. You're never going to want for anything. And you're going to dwell safely. You'll be secure. Here's the blessing. Now watch this. There's a whole bunch of them. All the way down to verse 14. Here's the blessings. I will give peace in the land, and you shall lie down, and none shall make you afraid. Well, that's a good thing, isn't it? And I will rid evil beasts. Now understand, they didn't have the kind of houses and stuff we have. Evil beasts was a big deal. Can you imagine still living in California when there were grizzly bears? That's an eating machine with 4 or 5 inch claws that has a really bad attitude. But he said, I will drive out the evil beasts of the land. Neither shall the sword go through your land. There'll be no more war. You won't be afraid. Anything that would harm you, I'm going to drive out of the land. And you shall chase your enemy, and they shall fall before you with the sword. You'll always be victorious. If somebody invades you, you'll be victorious. 5 of you shall chase away 100, and 100 of you shall chase away 10,000. of your enemies, and they shall fall before you by the sword. I will have respect unto you, and I will make you fruitful, and I will multiply you, and I will establish my covenant with you. And you shall eat old store and bring forth the old store because of the new. You're going to eat to the point where you got to throw some stuff away because the new stuff has to be put in the storehouse that there's still stuff in. That's a good thing, isn't it? It's a terrible thing to look in your closet, ladies, and say, I got to throw some of these things away because I got a whole bunch of new clothes. Where am I going to put them in my closet? Like ladies throw anything away. My wife doesn't. Just get another closet. But that's the idea. You're, what God blesses you with will take you to the next blessing. You're never going to be without. Now watch this. And I will set my tabernacle among you. My presence will be in your midst. And my soul shall not abhor you. I'm going to love you. And I'm going to accept you. And I will walk among you and will be your God. And you shall be my people. I am the Lord your God, which brought you forth out of the land of Egypt, that you should not be their bondsmen. I have broken the bands of your yoke and made you to go upright. I've stood you up. I make you to stand, is the idea. God is saying, and notice the I wills, I will give you peace. I will rid your land of the evil beasts. I will have respect unto you. Listen, I will give you the power to drive your enemies away from you. I will set my tabernacle in your midst. I will walk among you. I will be your God. You will be my people. What a blessing. And it's all connected to obedience. To obey is better than sacrifice, to hearken. Now, does that obedience mean perfection? No, because even in the Levitical law, he set up, again, as we said before, a procedure, if you sin, to get back right with God. If it's a sin offering or a trespass offering. In the New Testament, we read in 1 John, and it's one of my favorite chapters in all of the Bible, 1 John, chapter 1. On into chapter 2. Because there's a wonderful principle laid out there in 1 John chapter 1 verse 8. Because there's John says, if you say that you don't have a bent to sin, a propensity to sin, you deceive yourself. How many have a propensity to sin? We all do. But if you confess your sin, he is just and faithful to cleanse you of all unrighteousness. And the third part of it. But if you say what you're doing is not sin, the truth is not in you, and you deceive yourself. And then John goes into chapter 2, and he says this, my little children, I write unto you that you sin not. That should be the standard. But if you do, you need to know you have an advocate with the Father, Jesus the righteous, whoever lives to make intercession for you. And by the way, he became the propitiation for your sin. Not only the payment, but he satisfied the righteous demands of the Father and every emotion connected with that when he died on Calvary's cross. So that's the idea here. Listen, walking in God's will means that you're obedient. And, if you sin against him, that you're obedient in bringing that sacrifice. So he's saying, if you will do that, all of these things will be yours. But watch verse 14. But if you will not hearken, now we need to look at this language very carefully, because this is not somebody who's trying to serve the Lord that's making mistakes. How many want to serve the Lord with all your heart? Want to walk in his will, walk in his ways, want to be pleasing to the Father? How many of you still sin? See, that's a whole different creature than what was before us here. Watch what he says. Listen to the language. But if you will not hearken, the word for hearken there in the Hebrew is to listen with the intent to be obedient. If you stop listening to God with the intent to be obedient, if you will not hearken unto me, watch this, and will not do these things I command, you stiffen your neck, you're rebellious, you're just not going to do it. And if you despise my statutes, that means you're a scorner of the word. You despise my statutes. Or if your soul abhors, you hate my judgments. So that you will not do all of my commandments, but that you break my covenant. You're breaking it. You're saying, I don't want anything more to do with you, Lord. I can't stand the word. I can't stand, you know, church. I can't stand. Listen, I don't want anything more to do with you. That's the idea here. And they did do this. As we're going to see as we move our way through the Old Testament. Then he says this, now watch the I wills of God. Verse 16. I also will do this unto you. If you despise my word and reject and become rebellious, then this is what I'm going to do. I will even appoint over you a terror of consumption. That's disease. And a burning kind of a boil kind of a thing is what it is. And shall consume the eyes and cause sorrow of the heart. And you shall sow your seed in vain. Your crops are not going to produce. For your enemy shall eat it. And I will set my face against you, and you shall be slain before your enemies. They that hate you shall reign over you, and you shall flee when none pursueth you. Now watch this, verse 18. And if you will not yet for all of this hearken unto me. God is doing that to bring repentance. Four times we're going to see in this chapter that God says, I'm going to do this to bring you to repentance. It's discipline. But if you don't hearken when I do that, then I will punish you seven times more for your sins. Why do you think during the tribulation period we had seven seals, seven trumpets, seven vials? Each one of those was to bring people to repentance. And when they didn't, God sent seven other plagues. He's saying here in the Old Testament, listen, if you abandon my ways and forsake my commandments and abhor and hate me and rebel against me, then I will send these plagues upon you to bring you to repentance. And if I send the first series of plagues and you don't hearken, then I will punish you seven times more for your sin. Verse 19, and I will break the pride of your power, and I will make your heavens as iron and your earth as brass. And your strength shall be spent in vain, for your land shall not yield her increase, neither shall the trees of the land yield their fruit. And then he says this, verse 21. And if you walk contrary unto me and will not hearken, now I've sent that and you still didn't hearken, then I will send seven times more plagues upon you according to your sins. What I see here is God's mercy. He's just not willing to give up. I will send wild beasts among you, and they shall rob you of your children and destroy your cattle and make you few in number. And your highways shall be, that's the high places they set these idols up on, shall be desolate. And if you will not reform by these things, then I will walk contrary to you. Here's the next set. Then I will also walk contrary to you. I will punish you yet seven times for your sins. I will bring a sword upon you, and you shall, and that shall avenge in a quarrel of my covenant. And when you are gathered together with your cities, I will send pestilence upon you, and you shall be delivered into the hands of your enemies. And when I have broken the staff of your bread, and 10 women are trying to bake in one oven, they shall deliver unto you bread again by weight, and you shall eat and not be satisfied. And then God says this in verse 27, and if you will not for all of this hearken unto me, but walk contrary to me, then I will walk contrary. Watch this process. God is saying, I'm going to discipline you, and hopefully that'll turn you back. And if it doesn't, I'm going to discipline you seven times more. I'm not giving up on you. You're going to go to the woodshed seven times more. And if you don't hearken, then I'm going to discipline you more, seven times more. I'm going to get your attention. Then I will walk contrary unto you in fury. And I will chasten you seven times more for your sin. And you shall eat the flesh of your sons. And this happened. The enemy surrounded Jerusalem. And when they were starving, they began to commit one of the most awful sins as they began to eat their own. God says, if you don't, then this is what's going to happen. And you shall eat the flesh of your sons, and the flesh of your daughters you shall eat. And I will destroy the high places and cut down your images and cast down the carcasses upon the carcasses of your idols. And my soul shall abhor you. I will make your cities waste, and I will bring your sanctuaries unto desolation. And I will not smell the sweet savor of your sacrifice. And I will bring the land into desolation, and your enemies shall dwell therein. We know that when Babylon came in and led them captivity, when Jeremiah was crying, this was what was going on in the land. And I will make your enemies to come in, he says, and to dwell therein, and shall astonish it all. at all. And then he says in verse 33, and this is very, we're only going to go down a few more verses. And I will scatter you among the heathen. Babylonians came in, the Assyrians came in, led them captive. And I will draw out a sword after you, and your land shall be desolate, and your cities waste. You remember when Nehemiah went to survey. Now, Zerubbabel and Joshua, the high priest, had gone after the Babylonian 70-year captive and built the temple. And then Nehemiah comes, and the walls are broken down, and the enemies are coming in with their sorties constantly and just absolutely having their way with the people. And in chapter 1 of Nehemiah, as we're going to see when we get next week to verse 40, Nehemiah no doubt read Leviticus and said, "Forgive us. We have sinned against you. Our fathers have sinned against you. We have broken your covenant. We've cast off your authority. And we're asking that you would forgive because you said, God, you said in Leviticus chapter 26, verse 40, that if we did all of these things, you would discipline us. And we have done all of these things, and you have disciplined us. And now we're living in a strange land under the authority of strange kings, and we're being abused. But you said that if we turn back to you, that you'd save us, that you'd forgive us, that you'd restore us." And what we're seeing here will be fulfilled during the days of Jeremiah's warning, during the Babylonian captivity, and then coming back. Now watch the connection here. Verse 33, you shall be scattered among the heathen, and they will draw out a sword after you, and your land shall be desolate, and your cities. Then shall the land enjoy Sabbath. The 490 years that they were in the land, they never gave the land the Sabbath rest. They didn't stop planting on the sixth year and let God bless them, because the blessing was so great on the sixth year, they planted the seventh, and they started over. They never gave the land, as God instructed, the Sabbath rest. And so God, for 490 years, tolerated their absolute disobedience until he sent the Babylonians and the Assyrians to remove them. And how long were they in the Babylonian captivity? 70 years. There were 70 Sabbaths that they didn't get the land to rest. God always gets his Sabbath. Watch this. Then shall the land enjoy her Sabbath as long as it lieth desolate and you be in your enemy's land. Even then shall the land rest and enjoy her Sabbath. As long as it lieth desolate, it shall rest, because it did not rest in your Sabbaths when you dwelt in it. So I'm going to get my Sabbaths back. And upon them that are left alive of you, I will send a faintness into your hearts in the land of your enemies. You're going to be broken there. And the sound of a shaken leaf shall chase them. You're going to be skittish. And you shall flee, and fleeing from the sword. And you shall fall when none pursueth you. And they shall fall one upon another as if they were to fall upon a sword, and none shall pursue you, and you shall have no power to stand before your enemies. I'm going to take that from you. And you shall perish among the heathen, and the land of your enemies shall eat you up, and they that are left of you shall pine away. You're just going to waste away in their iniquity in your enemy's land, and also in the iniquities of your fathers shall you pine away with them. Now, that's a pretty bad picture, isn't it? And Israel went through this time. But watch verse 40, and we'll just read a verse, and then we'll leave off with that. But then it says, but if, here's a condition, if they shall confess their iniquity and the iniquity of their fathers with their trespasses, which they have trespassed against me, and that also they have walked contrary unto me, and that I also have walked contrary unto them, and have brought them into the land of their enemies, if then their uncircumcised hearts will be humbled, and if then they will accept the punishment of their iniquity, then I will remember my covenant with Jacob, and also my covenant with Isaac, and also my covenant with Abraham, and I will remember, and I will remember the land. Boy, isn't this just absolutely parallel our lives. You think about it for a moment. God blesses, and you enjoy the blessing of the Lord. And pretty soon, the blessing becomes more important than the Lord. And you begin to walk contrary to the Lord, and then he disciplines. And man, you need to turn at the first discipline. But if you don't, seven times worse, and seven times worse, and seven times worse, and seven times worse, till finally God gets your attention. And what he's saying, when I get your attention and you turn back to me, what you're going to find is grace and mercy waiting for you. It's the whole picture that Jesus taught in the story of the prodigal son. You remember he had two sons. One obedient, one disobedient. And the rebel came to him one day and said, give me everything that's mine. I'm out of here. I don't want to live under your rules. I don't want to live under your roof. I just don't like how I'm treated here. Give me everything that's mine. I'm out of here. And you know the story. He spent all that he had on riotous living, to the point where a good Jewish boy has to get down and slop with pigs. And as he's slopping with the pigs, the Bible says he comes to his senses. And he says, the servants in my father's house live better than this. I'm going home. Maybe, perchance, I can become one of his servants. And the indication in the story is that as he's coming up the driveway, maybe it's a long driveway, the father is standing there waiting for him. And he runs and he embraces him for two reasons. Number one, it would have been the right of his neighbor to take that rebellious son and have him stoned to death. We just read through that section a few weeks ago. And secondly, to show him that he loves him. And he says to his servants, kill the fatted lamb or the fatted calf. We're throwing a party tonight. Bring a ring and put it upon his finger and a robe upon his back and shoes upon his feet. For that which is lost is found. There was no chiding. There's no discipline. Now you're home. You're my son. I love you. Ring on your finger. Coat on your back. Shoes on your feet. Party for you tonight. I don't think that should be called the story of the prodigal son. I think it should be called the story of the unforgiving brother. Because the brother comes in from the field and he says, what is this? I was here all the time. I never went off into rebellion, and now you're throwing a party for him? He says, is it not right that we should throw a party for him? Your brother was lost and now he's found. He was gone and now he's home. God is gracious to us, is he not? And merciful. And if he has to discipline, it's for one purpose and one purpose only. God doesn't punish his people, he disciplines them. There's a big difference. The discipline is to drive you to repentance. If you are under God's discipline, man, just give up. Repent. Quit. Stop being like Jacob, who's wrestling with the Lord. Finally, God touches his side. He walks with a limp, and he's no longer called dirty, rotten thief. That's what Jacob means, dirty, rotten thief. But he's called he who is ruled by God, Israel. If tonight there's a little Jacob in you, man, listen, walk with a limp. And let God do what God is trying to do and bring you under submission. Humble yourself. Amen? That whole scene there was for that purpose. Look at what God did to those people. He never gave up on them. Now we know in Nehemiah that the walls were restored, the temple was rebuilt, and everything went back to normal when they repented. Did it not? Did it not? Everything can go back the way it was if you will humble yourself. Amen? Confess your sin. Repent. Turn from those wicked things and seek the Lord. Amen? Beautiful. Now we'll finish out Leviticus next week. Let's stand. I used up the worship leader's time again. And we'll just pray. I'll lead you in the last song. Father, we thank you tonight for your word. And Lord, as we're just working our way through this, the Old Testament, and now we're coming to the end of the book of Leviticus, there's just some really interesting things that are there. And again, Father, as we look at these things, may you give permanency to them in our hearts this evening. Speak to us through these things, Father. Don't let your word return void. Those things that we needed to hear, those things that were personal to us, those things that needed to instruct us, may we hear those things tonight, Father. May we hear your voice through your word. And may your Holy Spirit take it and make it permanent in our lives. And we pray these things in the mighty name of Jesus. And all God's kids would say, amen. I love you, Lord. I do. And I lift my voice to worship you, oh my soul. And it does. Rejoice. Take joy, my King, in what you hear. Let it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ear. You know, this country may have removed those pillars, but Lord, may this church and may each individual of this church have their lives built upon those pillars, that you are the creator. You are the sustainer. Your word, Father, is the absolute authority in my life. And I understand my need for a Savior. We thank you for your word tonight, Lord. Bless these that come out on Wednesday nights just to walk through it, especially the Old Testament, so important. Bless them as they go home, Father. Keep them this week. May your face shine upon them. May you fill them, Lord, with just the power of your Holy Spirit. May you put in each and every one of us a hunger, Father, for your word. To read it, to study it, to be obedient to it. We pray in the mighty name of Jesus. And all God's kids would say, amen. Amen. Hey, if you need prayer, the elders will be here to pray with you and for you. Other than that, you're dismissed to fellowship or make your way home.